2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda today is a virtual evidence session with Diane Owenga, Programme Director at the Policy Project, Department of the Prime Minister and Cabinet in New Zealand, to inform our inquiry into effective Scottish Government decision-making. So good evening, Ms. Owenga, and welcome to the meeting. I understand you'll provide us with a short presentation on the New Zealand approach. So, over to you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me to share the approach that New Zealand has taken. So I'll just share my screen with you, and we shall be underway. Easier said than done. At this point, I'm getting a not responding message, which I'm sure will come. So I would just proceed as if this was functioning properly.
Sorry. Yeah, sure. We'll just suspend until we're back to where we were. Right, OK, I won't go through the introduction again, Dan. I'm really delighted you're back with us. So you hadn't...
I can't hear you now.
Well, I'm the kind of very handsome, charismatic one.
Obviously, yeah. I have got the only way I can see what I'm presenting to you is to have it covering much of the screen at this stage. But look, if, just to pick off, I'm realising that we need to leave time, for questions, so I will move on from the policy capability framework. I know you've got copies in front of you. We were talking about the different things that we did. We were got as far as number four, I think. So number five, self-evident, promote awareness and use of policy project framework tools and guidance. We take every opportunity we can, whether it's social media, whether it's at events, newsletters, etc. We aim to do this because we actually think that if people were just to use, if most people were using these, we think we could really make some ground. But we've still got a ways to go to achieve that. And finally, we monitor our performance. And I think I was mentioning we've actually recently had an independent evaluation. So there's just two more slides very quickly before I get to question time. The two things were. You'll see on the second to last page that we refer to a range of other online resources for building policy skills knowledge. We have spent a bit of time building some resources people can use. In the policy methods toolbox, you'll see the range of things we're doing there. Those are designed to help people with some of the newer ways of approaching things, design thinking, futures thinking, and so forth, but also just some things that can make you do a better job of getting policy projects off to a good start, like Start Right. And we also have guidance under policy advice themes on our website. The area we've been doing a lot of work in particularly recently is the policy, the interface between policy and the law. And finally, to come to the question of long-term insights briefing. So basically, I guess this is one of these areas where we've kind of got involved in policy system change or government system change. This concern that the government, that the public service responding to ministers often, we're very focused in the short term. We were asked when the Public Service Act was being written after about 25 years, whether we felt that just having stewardship as a value inside the Public Service Act was enough, or whether there should be some actual requirements to do more about it. And we came back and said, we actually think that if you don't make it something that has to be done, chances are the short-term stuff will always push out the long-term. And so the things that chief executives now have to do is that they have a duty, a statutory duty, to publish a long-term insights briefing in the public arena every 3 years. And they can do that either agency by agency, or they can club together if they think there's a topic of common interest that's important. What's interesting about this instrument is that it's independent of ministers. It's actually the public service doing producing a think piece out there in the public domain, tabled in Parliament, discussed at a select committee about the following thing, and that's at the bottom left of that page. What they've got to do in these briefings is to make available information about medium and long-term trends, risks and opportunities that might affect or may affect New Zealand and New Zealand society. That's not the short-term stuff, it's the medium and long-term things. They've got to provide some impartial analysis about that, which so it says, here's the things that might be changing. They may be risks, there may be opportunities. What are the policy options that might exist to deal with the risks or to make the most of the opportunities? And there's an option to assess the pros and cons or the strengths and weaknesses of the different options. They're not asked to go as far as advice. So this is to get the debate happening about these issues, not for advice necessarily perhaps by this government. It may be a post, you know, it might be after a further election or even two that the real decisions might get made. On the right-hand top side of that slide, I have just showed the steps that are involved, and you'll see that the other thing that's interesting about them is that the public does get to come in at during the process. It's actually at three stages. Early on, when people have done some initial analysis and they say, we think this is the key topic, say, in the health area or in the transport area or whatever, this is why, this is the topic and this is why, the public gets to give feedback on that. Then the briefing is developed, and then there's public consultation on the draft briefing, and then it is given to a minister solely as a posting box to go to Parliament. And then, obviously, at select committee stage, there's a possibility for public engagement as well. So just to give you a sense of where this is at, the first round of briefings was for the 2021 to 23 period. The 28 government departments are producing 19 topics, so a few people agencies are working together. Quite varying approaches, we're just starting to sort of assess them, quite varying approaches. Some are very, very, you know, professionally done futures thinking. Others, I would say, are less strong in that area. Very different approaches to engaging with citizens as well. Seven of them are still yet to be tabled in Parliament, and when those have got there, we will then be launching a review of the first round so we can update the guidance and they can get into the next round. And for me, this has been one of the more exciting things in a way for me. I know that actually since 2001, the public service has done more future-focused work and thinking than it had done in the previous probably 15 or 20 years. And so, you know, it's quite exciting to see that, but we're still early days to think about how it will improve things for New Zealanders. You know, it's a long-term process. So look, I'll leave it there, and very happy to answer any questions that you have about any aspect of what I've covered.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if colleagues got everything that you said, but I think we'll certainly ask questions and probe, and thank you very much for the opening introduction. I mean, I'll kick off before I invite colleagues round the table to come in with some questions. And I think the first question I would really like to ask is to go back to the start of the process regarding the Public Service Act 2020. Now, obviously, that followed on from a previous act 32 years previously, but I'm just wondering why it was felt that legislation was actually needed, you know, in order to try and change the cultures and behaviours that obviously you had in New Zealand.
This was the long-term insights briefing was a very small piece of this. I think the more, if I just try and channel our state services, our public service commissioner as he now is, and what he would say about why we had to change the act, he would focus on the fact that the world is moving in ways that require less silos, you know, less separate individual agencies operating separately, and needed more mechanisms to be able to flexibly work across the usual departmental boundaries. And so the Act does provide more of those. There's been a strong view as well, I mentioned the issue with the treaty and with, you know, Māori, our Indigenous people. There was also a feeling that actually there wasn't enough, well, there was virtually no reference to that in the previous legislation. So there were, you know, there were lots of little areas that needed attention. Much of what was covered, though, came forward from the previous Act. So we still have strong degree of independence of individual government, the chief executives. You know, we do not have a strongly centrally led public service. It's a lot of the power in our Act gives the power to the individual heads of government agencies rather than the Public Service Commission, and that was essentially rolled forward.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, you touched on your presentation in terms of the long-term insights briefing, which you mentioned is at least once every 3 years. And one of the key points of that is that the public can contribute to future decision-making, helping them to collectively, as a country, think about and plan for the future. Now, I realise the Act was only passed in 2020 and with the pandemic, but I'm just wondering if there is any evidence or signs that that has actually transpired or is starting to happen?
Well, I think it's probably a decade would almost be required, I think, to see the whole thing roll through, because it takes almost 3 years to produce one. And the issues you're talking about are not intended to be decided on by, or at least largely not, by this current government, but the next government. You know, so if we were to sort of trace one set of issues. So what I can see now is that there has been somewhat more engagement and focus on some longer term issues, but we're not at the point where there are decisions, and you could sort of say you can't draw the line yet, you know, between what was in an individual report and what anybody's yet done, you know. But that's not a failure, it's just that it takes time to work through these processes.
Okay, thanks very much. And, you know, I noticed there's a head of the policy profession who's responsible for improving the policy system, capabilities, processes, standards, and helping to improve the outcomes they contribute to, including higher quality policy advice, better government decisions, and better outcomes for people in New Zealand. So, and the report we have goes on to talk about how a sample of policy advice papers is assessed by a panel. So I just wonder if you've got a kind of example of how that has worked in practical terms. And also, how do you ensure objectivity in that process as opposed to subjectivity?
So I guess we're trying to ensure everybody is required to use the same measuring stick, which is the policy quality framework. And we have guidance for panels that tells, you know, there's a common approach to selecting the sample. It's a random selection process. You can't go through and say, here's all our best papers. You assess asking how well is each paper done on context, analysis, advice, action. We've got advice on some of the trickier issues like, what if this one had to be written overnight? You know, should we say it's not a very fantastic paper, but given you only had 24 hours to do it, so we say no, we shouldn't look at those requirements. You should look at just what, you know, how it does on these facets. There is, of course, some scope for disagreement. We've actually got some work underway at the moment where we're testing that. So we've actually drawn a couple of papers, one scored a 3, one scored a 4 from every agency, and then we've had one small panel of experienced people who are on other panels to independently score them and compare. And what we found was, yes, there was a bit of variability, but actually not significantly amounts of variability. So, in some ways, it's not the absolute score that's the most important thing about it. The important thing is that the agencies are saying, what did I do? And there's a report that comes alongside the score and it says, you know, yes, this is the trend in your scores, but also what are the things you are doing best at and what are the areas that most need development? And it's that continuous improvement of feedback of that information that is actually, I think, more important than the score. But the score is still it's useful to know that you used to be an agency that mostly scored 4s and now for some reason you're scoring 2.5, you know? Mm-hmm. That's useful information. But what you would do about it, you need to have the information about the areas that you're doing well in and more importantly, the areas you're not doing well in, and then you need to plan to address them. And it's enabling people to focus in and take this seriously. And I've noticed, I've been in this role 6 years, there's a lot more talk about, and there is more focus on it, and people are talking the same kind of action, and people are sort of saying, well, they do really well all the time. What is it they do better at, you know? And it gives you some of those, some signals and some information to do better, to help you do better.
Yeah, so this process effectively helps best practice being inculcated across the entire government. Yeah. I mean, yeah, I noticed in terms of the interim evaluation commissioned in late 2020, there were a number of points touched on, and one of them was talked about the fast-paced change of policy work and the difficulties of changing entrenched behaviours. What kind of entrenched behaviours are there that need to be changed in New Zealand?
Okay. Well, I think I referred to engagement before with people. I think one of the entrenched behaviours is policy people in New Zealand, and I don't think they're much different than in most other countries, think that they should do a lot of thinking and work independently of the population affected by an issue before they go and talk to them. You know, bit of a tendency to think that they should become an expert working inside the system. So one of the things, you know, that we would advise people to do is go out and talk early. How do people affected by the problem see it? You know, what do they think is causing it? Policy people are very different. They're not necessarily representative of the whole population and sometimes cannot see things as they're affecting citizens out there easily. citizens who might be much less educated and much poorer and not living in cities, you know, for example. So I think that's one of the things that I think has been, you know, moving on that is something that needs, and it is slowly happening. And sometimes it's not done either just, it's not just officials who sometimes are not so keen on that. Sometimes it's their political masters, which is another issue.
Okay, thanks. And I notice, I mean, this resonates because I think we have some of the same issues here in Scotland. But, it says capacity issues and speed of decision-making makes prioritisation and following those processes challenging and also favours decision-making focused on firefighting rather than addressing longer-term challenges and squeezes the time for data analysis and identification of data gaps at the start of policy development. So how is the kind of new process that you have in New Zealand being able to overcome this kind of long-term difficulty that I think so many administrations face?
I think it's a really tricky one, isn't it? Because citizens expect action from government, and therefore government expect quick turnaround of advice from officials so that they can deliver to citizens. It is kind of tricky. I guess that's why we're trying to at least engender a culture of, you know, a paper without evidence is really not a good paper at all. And it's something we can't do centrally, because actually the information you need is very topic and agency specific or sector specific. You know what good data sets might be and what good evidence sources might be and engagement approaches might be for the health sector could be very different from, say, conservation of natural resources or whatever. So again, as I said, we'd be trying to, you know, I think there is, I think your average policy person is trained in ways that mean they have a high respect for evidence, but they just don't necessarily have time to do it, or they're not necessarily, their agencies could sometimes do better at making sure it's easy to get to evidence quickly, you know, when you need it. So it's not just about the individuals changing, it's about the systems changing. And those things are resource intensive if you're going to do them well. So sometimes there's a financial constraint.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And I'm only going to ask one more question, then I'm going to open out the session to colleagues around the table. On Sunday, a book called How Westminster Works and Why It Doesn't by a man called Ian Dunn was reviewed in the Sunday Times. What was interesting was it talked about a technique that they have in the civil service at Westminster called boxing in, and that's a situation whereby civil servants allegedly give ministers four or five different options, all of one of which are completely bonkers, and one is sensible, in order to try and channel the minister into taking one decision. The article did point out that Liz Truss kind of broke that by always going for one of the mad options, but when she was Prime Minister and Minister. But generally speaking, it's a serious point, because it means that the ministers are corralled into a certain direction. So I'm just wondering if that's an issue that actually happens in New Zealand. Does that take place? Is that something you have experience of?
I have, no, I'm not, but I will get the book. sounds intriguing. I'm just to see if there's a break. No, I haven't. I haven't had a single conversation of that as a way of managing the process. It's counter to what the advice the policy project would provide. You know, strongly counter. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm pleased to hear that. So thank you very much. Okay, so the first colleague to ask questions round table will be Deputy Convener Daniel Johnson, to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you very much. I think one of the sort of very typical reactions you get when you're trying to implement a kind of a consistent methodology across an organisation is for people to go, well, that all makes an awful lot of sense, but our area is special and we don't need to follow it. And then the other thing I think you see quite a lot in the public sector is that, you know, the way that a lot of public bodies will get around that is that, well, they just carry on doing what they're doing, but they'll present their findings or their thoughts publicly in line with the methodology, but actually behind the scenes carry on doing what they were doing. I'm just sort of wondering to what extent those things have been apparent and how much actually this has driven fundamental change in practice, or how much of it is simply about presentation of existing practice, and I think overall how much resistance has there been to this approach?
I think I was lucky that the idea of having a score of your policy advice was brought about 2 or 3 years before I came on the scene. What I succeeded in doing was getting them to use the same measuring stick. So at that stage, they said, you've got to measure it, but it's up to you to decide what framework you use, you know. I think, yes, it's true that when you share the results with agencies showing where they all are on it, then all the ones at the lower end will certainly want to talk about the special circumstances they face. And that's fair enough. If I was in their shoes, I probably would too, you know. But nonetheless, they've got a kind of sense of, oh, I am, you know, I'd like to be higher up that picture. We don't make a big deal of the league table type approach, but you know, but we do it. It's not, you know, it's for their discussion and purposes. In terms of the no, I don't think they are. I think their resources are too small to be able to sort of run a separate evaluation approach. And because it's a random sampling of any of their papers, you know, it's kind of like, well, any of them could be, you know, so it's, we've kind of got some of the incentives, I think, right to do it. For some of them, it is right, you know, it is compliance, but I see an increasing proportion who say, oh, actually, there is some benefit we get out of it, you know. And that links back to that comment I made to your colleague earlier, that it's about that continuous improvement stuff, you know, so it's not the score so much as the additional information that you get. And so, no, I think people are, now, when we did the measuring stick as well, the other reason people have bought in, I think, is that we sort of said, we'll have this common measuring stick, but we will collectively create a measuring stick that we all think is best in class, you know. And so, so everybody who had a measuring stick, they got to bring theirs along and explain why their, you know, system was good. And from that, we created one which was signed off then by the whole system as being our system, you know. So it's been a bit more collaborative than some of those sorts of compliance-based systems. Yeah.
So thank you very much for that. And I just moving on sort of thematically, we embarked on this inquiry in terms of government decision-making in a very broad sense. And I think that was as much actually thinking about how the government makes decisions about managing the day-to-day as circumstances change, as opposed to policy making, which is about what you want to do in the future. But actually what's interesting is you speak to both politicians and officials, and they naturally only talk about policy, and it's only actually when prompted or prodded that they talk about delivery. And I just wondered whether or not there are comparable approaches to looking at actually how you, once the policy is set, is actually how that is then implemented and also then managed in the steady state, because those things are often as important, if not actually more important, than that upfront initial analysis and policy, you know, which is about what you want to do in the future.
I agree that you want to have good decisions made and then you want them implemented well, or otherwise you're not going to get the end benefits you're talking about. We don't have, I mean, I think it's because in a way it's more multi, you know, the realities of implementation can be so different in different sectors that, you know, who's doing the implementing, you know, like there's some things that are being implemented by government agencies and their delivery arms out there, but there are others that are being implemented by local government, or sometimes even by sector organisations, you know what I mean? There's kind of a self-regulation process maybe going on or things like that amongst businesses. So it's harder to have a common measuring stick, I think, out there. The approach we've taken is, for that area, the government has taken, is to say, actually, there is some, we can, you know, things have fallen over sometimes in the past. They've not, you know, worked out nearly as well as we thought. And so we now have an implementation unit in the Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet, so some of my colleagues. Their job is to select some what are seen as really key projects and to really keep the focus on implementation. The other approach that's being taken is to try and foster more post, it's more evaluation after implementation, you know, so that we actually know what were the outcomes. If they didn't work out as expected at the policy stage, why not, you know, what could be done about it? Again, that continuous improvement model. It's still an area where I don't think we do well, and I've yet to meet a government that, or you know, to hear of a government that really does do very well in that area. Politicians tend to want to get their decisions made, and then they may not be around when implementation's happened, and if it hasn't gone well, they're not necessarily so keen to have it all out there, you see. So I mean, I think there's a few things that explain why that's not a strength in any country that I've come across.
That's interesting. The final thing I wanted to ask was, I think one of the things that probably strikes most of us as interesting is the move by the Cabinet in New Zealand to publish all of their Cabinet papers, both for Cabinet and subcommittees of Cabinet, in public within 30 yeah. days. And that is quite a striking contrast to how things are done both in Scotland and in Westminster, where you know there are 30-year rules. These things don't emerge until decades after these things have been discussed. To what extent has that made a difference? Or, I mean, the other thing that we have seen is that when these transparency measures are brought in, is that essentially both the administration and ministers do everything they can to avoid the channels so that these things might be recorded. So this is the you know the rise of government by WhatsApp. Has it improved things, or has it sort of pushed things into the shadows?
I'm really not in a good position to know, because we focus on the policy process and policy capability, but we don't focus on policy content. You know, our job in the policy project is not to give advice on health policy or whatever. So I don't actually get to see the discussions, and therefore I don't know the difference between the discussions and what gets published. It may, but really we had a very, you know, we transitioned from an Official Secrets Act to quite a strong Official Information Act a long time ago now. So they're really, this is just the last step, you know, on what was already pretty easy to get. The only stuff you could withhold was stuff that was still subject to free and frank advice, in the sense that, you know, there was still a decision-making process underway. And as soon as that was finished, in principle, if someone asked for it, you had to give it anyway. Now, instead of waiting for someone to ask, it goes up there on a website, you know. So it's not a big difference for us. It's another step, but it's So I haven't noticed a lot of talk about it amongst officials here. You know, it didn't seem to them. I don't think it's been such a big deal. If there was a really big deal issue, you'd probably be saying to the minister, well, there is a clause you can use to not have to proactively release, and, you know, we think you should apply that. So there's still a backstop. Yeah.
Thank you very much. That's very helpful, and I'll hand over at that point.
Thank you very much. Michelle, to be followed by John.
Good evening. Thank you for joining us, and what it must be very late in your day. I'm thinking about the kind of similarities between Scotland and New Zealand, and one of the things I often say about Scotland is the best thing about it is everybody knows everybody. The worst thing about it is everybody knows everybody. What we tend to find is that we bring in similar reps, similar panels, and we work very hard to try and get differentiation, but sometimes it's hard because of the size of the pool. I'm wondering if that is a similar issue for you in New Zealand, and if so, to what extent have you actively considered how it affects effective decision-making and quality of delivery?
Can I just ask a clarifying question? So when you say, you mentioned panels?
Yeah, I mean
kind of pool?
Yeah, pool of people with whom we would consult for external evidence.
Okay. No, I mean, I think that's an issue here too. I mean, we also a small, you know, a small country, although quite a big land area, quite spread out. There's those people who you're going to hear from whether you want to or not. They'll always be there to tell you what they think. And then there's some you can find with a little bit of effort, if you go back to them more than require them to come to you. And then there's people who are really hard to reach, I think. And the only thing we've been able to do about that in the role I'm in is at least to develop some guidance that sort of says, okay, if you want to have inclusive engagement that doesn't just go to the same old candidates, you know, here's some techniques you can use, you know, just sort of pull that together, and also to sort of help people understand which government agencies can reach into those communities. So for us, this might be our Māori and Pacific Island communities, but it might be our disabled communities and so forth. We've got agencies who've got responsibilities and networks and skills in those areas, and it's a matter of getting people to use them more, I think.
Thank you. And following on from that, I noticed in your policy methods toolbox, which describes how to use behavioural insights. Can you tell us a bit more about that? What sort of training do people go through? And I'm particularly interested in how you actively avoid groupthink and the adverse influence of power structures, where the inclination is always to accede to the person in the level above you in the hierarchy. So how embedded are these behavioural insights, and how well trained are the people that are using them and kept up to speed?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think in New Zealand, I think we're probably less resourced and perhaps coming later to the party than perhaps some other countries. I mean, I know that in the UK, you know, back in the Blair government times, you know, he had a behavioural insights unit inside his, you know, 10 Downing Street and so forth. People were writing books about that, and so there's, you know, there was kind of more focus on it. People with sort of a range of backgrounds from psychology and sometimes behavioural economics and so forth. We've got a small subset of people who call themselves behavioural insights specialists or equivalent. And I mean, I guess the reason we've got stuff on our website is that almost everything government does is to do with behaviour change. You know, that's always what we're, you know, it comes down to what people do, and we're trying to influence them in various ways. And so it's probably good to put that lens on it and to get people thinking about, well, what is the behaviour, but also how difficult is behavioural change? I mean, for a variety of reasons, but which include power structures, as you pointed out. So to try and get people kind of observant of it, and then just sort of asking, what can we learn? So it's using some of those less heavy hammers, you know. So we always have tended to think about behavioural change being something we do through, you know, laws and regulations. You know, you can do this, you can't do that. If you do it, this is what will happen to you. Or through financial, you know, we'll subsidise what we like, or we'll tax what we don't like, you know, that sort of stuff. So there's a whole lot of stuff in that space where you just actually do subtle things to change the choice context that officials often haven't thought enough about, you know. So what we can do, so there's those things about, you know, so our problem is people are not paying their fines. Well, it turns out if you couch the letter better, that reminds them that your fines are due, and you get it sent to them at a better time, and et cetera, et cetera. You know, some of those things, you can influence behaviour in subtle ways. So what we've been trying to do is just at least to get people to put that lens on more, but it's actually, it is hard stuff to change, especially power structures.
And I suppose that just leads on to my last question about culture. You know, I mean, I suppose culture is a kind of summing up of a whole bunch of behaviours. when you were developing your methodology in 2020, did you step back and actively look at the culture of how you deliver change, and did you compare it to other countries, and what sort of findings remain constant just, you know, a few years down the track?
We were interested in what other countries were doing. We were constrained by the fact that at this particular period, ministers were not saying we want a lot more futures thinking. That wasn't their particular priority. So we were constrained by things we could do within the ambit of the public service. You know, so some countries like Wales, you're not so far away, part of the world. You know, they've got their commissioner on for the future generation or generations or equivalent, and planning is being required at every level of government and every sector and so forth to ask what would this mean for future generations. We didn't have a political appetite for that. So there was a necessity of actually saying to the minister, this is something the public service could be doing, you know. So we were constrained by what we could get agreement to at that point in time. And so that was the initiative. I mean, again, there's some interesting things in other parts of Europe that are very involve Parliament more. I mean, I guess we have involved Parliament in the sense of the select committee process. That's still playing out. That's still a new thing. I'm not sure. I haven't been able to actually focus too much on. I haven't been to any of the hearings yet, for example. It's really interesting that every country's done something quite different, and I think that has to do with the sort of the context at that point in time. Probably, yeah.
Okay. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, John. To be followed by Ross.
Thanks, convener, and thanks for taking part. I was intrigued in relation, I think, to the kind of long-term planning and thinking that public servants, we call them, as compared to our civil servants, are. Yeah. Producing briefings independently of ministers. And I was interested in the relationship, therefore, between ministers and public servants, because we see that as very close, and civil servants or public servants wouldn't really say anything that wasn't in line with the minister. So can you describe a little how that relationship is different in New Zealand?
It's only this bit that is different. So it was a departure. For all the rest is just as you described, you know. So essentially, it's ministers who talk to the media. It's ministers who set political priorities. Officials help them achieve, you know, figure out the best way to achieve them. So the decision was taken, though, that if this was it was trying to get it to be a bit bipartisan. You know, it was trying to sort of say, okay, here we're serving this government and future governments, who may well be the ones who are actually going to have to make decisions about these things. And so it was decided to have that feature. This and only this is done independently of ministers. So ministers don't dictate which topic you choose. They don't dictate whether you work on it jointly with other agencies or not. They do not proofread. They're given a copy to give to Parliament. They're not given a copy in draft and asked what they'd like, you know, if there's anything they'd like changed. And so that was new territory. I guess we set the rule, you know, ministers were briefed soon after the Act was passed. So we did a briefing that sort of says, here's what these things are. Here's what's different about them. It is a different role than all the other things that come through. It was interesting. I waited with bated breath to see what would happen when we actually got to the point where they were being given to ministers. To my knowledge, there hasn't been any issues. I think there's been a consistent messaging came down from the Prime Minister that, you know, ministers shouldn't interfere with them, and they haven't. I suspect one or two of them might have wanted to, but the message they were given by our head of department was, you know, was that if that sort of pressure was starting to come on, that they should notify him. He would talk to the Prime Minister and that hopefully would resolve. But to my knowledge, that wasn't actually necessary.
Okay, thanks. That's very helpful. I mean, I think you said earlier that the civil servants wouldn't actually give advice, so they would lay out different options. Is that how it works? And then it would be for the Minister and or Parliament to kind of choose.
Exactly. Exactly. And so that also takes the heat off a bit, you see.
Yeah, I get that. Now, another point, I mean, you were asked earlier about why the changes were made with the new 2020 Act. And if I understood that correctly, one of the reasons was there was too much silo working. And that's something we have a big issue with as well. I realise it's early days, but are there signs that there's less silo working and more kind of across government?
Some of the new mechanisms that the Act enables, and honestly, I haven't focused on them strongly, so I can't give you specifics. Certainly, a number of them have been set up to work. And a recent example is we've had a very, you know, the biggest ever cyclone we've ever had, which, you know, created havoc in about a third of the country. And they're using one of those vehicles for that as well. You know, so it's a mechanism by which it ties up with the financial appropriations as well, so you can actually move some funding from, say, three agencies to this board that then can collectively do whatever they need to jointly do.
To suspend the session, John. Sorry, apologies.
Okay.
Diane. It appeared to be cut off when you were in mid-flow there. Can you hear me? Can we hear you?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. So, sorry, apologies. Yeah, we were cut off, I think, when you were responding to John. Incidentally, we were hoping that the session initially would only go on till about 10 past 10, but three colleagues have yet to speak, and we've lost over 20 minutes because of these interruptions. So would it be possible to extend the session a wee bit? I'd appreciate it.
I think, yes, that's fine. I'm happy to do that.
That's great. Well, thank you, Diana.
I got those dreaded words, network connectivity issues.
Yeah. Yes, okay. Well, okay, so I don't know if, John, if you want to remind us of what you were asking, Diane, there?
Yeah, well, I was asking about the silos and whether that had improved, so I'm not sure if you'd finished answering that, if you want to. And just the final point, I think I would ask... Yeah. Sorry, on you go.
Yeah. I'd just say that I think we've got more mechanisms for jointly working effectively across silos and on priority issues, you know, things that really the focus is on, it's going well. But I think it's another of those areas of entrenched behaviours. You know, it's challenging to get people to change what they've been doing for sometimes decades. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think we can identify with that here as well. And the final point I was going to ask was, when it comes to these long-term insights briefings and that kind of work, how much priority do you think that gets amongst public servants or even amongst ministers? You know, is it kind of tucked in at the end of the day because they've got to do it, or is it really a priority for them?
I think it varies from agency to agency and minister to minister. You know, there are some ministers who are absolutely insistent on every ounce of resource going on their priorities. And that's why we made them compulsory in the legislation, because the chief executive can say, look, Minister, it says here in this Act, I've got to do some of this stuff every 3 years. I don't think everybody's been having to point, but in some cases it's been helpful. So there's that dimension to it. I think public servants are generally, you know, I find policy people find this fascinating work, you know, so... It's not hard to convince them that it'd be interesting to try and, you know, get better at this. But it is, I think you're right, COVID this all had to happen during all the COVID stuff, and inevitably some of them are running late because resources did get channeled off to deal with COVID. But it was pretty hard to argue that that shouldn't be the priority. You know, I it was a fair enough call. I think it always will be an issue, but again, it's the cultural change. If, in fact, agencies themselves start to see some benefit, they start to see that they're on the front foot more, and it makes life easier later because you've done that research and investment, we should see more willingness, put more resource in that direction. I'm an optimist.
Okay, thanks very much. That's very helpful.
Thank you very much. Ross, to be followed by Liz.
Convener, I've got a couple of questions. For interest of time, I'm just going to roll into one. I'm interested in the point you made around the part of the role of what you compare to the Welsh Future Generations Commissioner approach is about, you know, fostering some bipartisanship to allow for that long-term thinking. Given that, you know, you got the ball rolling on this agenda under a centre-right government, but most of the time it's been bedding in, it's been under a centre-left government. You could potentially have a change of government later this year. How durable do you think this agenda is? Do you think this can survive a change of government? Has it become an established and agreed culture across the political spectrum in New Zealand? Or is it something that is ultimately dependent on the desire of a particular Prime Minister or Cabinet? And second part of that question is, when you're trying to break down silos and take a more holistic approach to government decision-making, how well do you think that works with multi-party government? Because I'm somewhat familiar with what you've got in that it's kind of a multi-party government, but your two Green ministers are in a bit of a silo from the Labour Cabinet. So does that breaking down of silos work when it's crossing between the responsibilities of ministers from different parties, where trust might be more of an issue than within the same party?
Good questions. So dealing with the second question first, actually, because let's stick with the first one first. Because it hasn't been deeply controversial yet, the reports that, you know, there's nothing yet kind of become front page headlines on the paper, because it's one of your colleagues pointed out earlier that we're not going as far as this is what you should do, future governments. We're just saying you should definitely focus on this issue, and here's a number of ways you could do it, and, you know, here's some of the things, the pros and cons. I think so long as it doesn't, the minute one government, one opposition is frying one government as a result of this work, it'll be at risk at the next election. So far, that hasn't been happening. It's pretty hard to argue against looking into the future, particularly when we've had COVID and stuff, and when most governments probably could have seen it, something like this coming, but most of us hadn't really drawn that much attention to it. It feels at the moment like it's not necessarily going to be a political football. The other thing is that this Public Service Act, you know, the interesting question is why was it 32 years since it was last reviewed? Well, it is one of those kinds of things, not the sort of thing you do every decade. So I would think that if it doesn't draw a lot of political ire, and because, you know, people like to be seen to be future thinking, you know, looking forward into the future, etc. Every government's going to want to be seen that way. My hunch is it will hang around for at least two or three goes, and it will only be when that act is being reviewed, I would predict, for something else, that people will ask a question, well, should we change that as well? And by then there may be a desire to do these things in a different way. There may be a desire to have a commission for the future or something else at that point, you know. And so I don't think the solution we've got is necessarily perfect or the best one. It was the one that was possible at a certain point. And if it evolves into something else, from my perspective, as the person who was involved in the advice at the beginning, that's fine, so long as we keep, as a country, asking what might be coming over the horizon and how can we be prepared for it.
Thanks. And on the second point there around multi-party government, I'm thinking particularly of your climate minister is a Green colleague of mine. I'm aware that he's frustrated with trying to get cross-portfolio work on climate because it requires it, but he does sit in somewhat of a silo compared to colleagues who've got responsibility for agriculture or whatever it might be. So how does this approach gel with a multi-party government?
Well, I mean, in a way, because of the independence of ministers of any party, it's not troubled by those issues. Those issues are interesting because they have a lot to do with the size of the vote of each party. So that's where things are now for the Green Party, party and the ministers. Two of them outside cabinet, but, you know, the election before that, they had quite a few more seats, and they had ministers in cabinet as well as outside cabinet. And so it's not, you know, these things keep changing. I think hopefully, you know, the people in the public service will see, you know, the key issues. In this case, by the way, climate change was already very actively underway by the government through that, you know, because of James Shaw's, you know, energy and commitment and that of his colleagues, as well as Prime Minister, who thought it was very important at that point, who's no longer the Prime Minister. So actually there isn't a long-term insights briefing on climate change because, you know, we've got a climate commission, we've got a, you know, whole lots of policy changes and choices have been made, and it wasn't felt that those were necessarily, therefore, you know, there were other things that weren't being worked on, which were picked up. Because, I guess, leading back, the key thing probably is that because we're independent of ministers, we don't have to worry about the coalition dynamics. And even if the main part of the coalition didn't want work to be done on something, or you know, was not planning to commission it themselves or officials, this process would allow officials to do some work on it. I hope that's going to work in a way that makes it easier to pick up things that parties who have a minority, it probably increases the chances they'd be incorporated and worked on, not rather than reducing it, I hope. But again, as I said before, I'm an optimist.
Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. And finally, Liz.
Just one question from me, if I may. If there is a piece of legislation in the Parliament that has not worked very well, as in has got, you know, lots of problems about it, could you just tell us how effective you think the post-legislative scrutiny is within that Parliament, and whether you think your group would ever be involved in looking at why that policy commitment didn't work very well?
No, we've been very, very firmly told that we're not into policy content, so that it wouldn't be us that would come to. It might be, I'm just trying to think about how that would work its way through. I'm pleased to say that I can't immediately think of an example of where something has worked out really badly, you know, that the legislative scrutiny, which ideally would pick those things up, kind of hasn't. I mean, those things would normally make their way back through the responsible minister and the responsible agency or agencies. An example is coming to mind. An example might be something like there were issues in the family court. So there were big backlogs of cases in the family court, and there was a review process and reform process that changed a whole number of dimensions of what people could do, both at the legal aid level and at the way the courts operated, and at a whole lot of levels. Okay, and it was supposed to make it better, and probably in some areas it did, but in a number of areas it actually made it harder for people. So what happened with that? Well, once it was starting to be evident, well, of course, the legal profession and others were lobbying and saying this, and parents groups and so forth were lobbying. So the normal processes applied. The minister then said, a subsequent minister then said, you know, maybe this was not the best thing that my predecessor did, and the whole set of work was set in train, and but it went back through those processes, which I, yeah. So we're not a mega group whose job is to be the judge and jury of whether something was good. In the end, responsibility remains with the agencies and ministers. Our responsibility is to work with them to help them improve the way they deliver, to build their capability and to build their quality of advice.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, well, thank you very much. And that's concluded questions from colleagues. Just one more from myself to finish off, and that's there are a number of similarities between Scotland and New Zealand in terms of its parliamentary structure. I mean, obviously the population isn't too different, but you've 120 members, we've 129. You've been a unicameral parliament since 1951. We're a unicameral parliament, and you've select committees and we have committees, and obviously your committees will interrogate policy and ministers, as will ours. So I'm just wondering how effective you feel that committee, select committee structure is in doing that. And finally, if there's one change you could make to make this process more effective, if you believe one change is necessary, what would that be?
So I don't think the process is broken, you know, in the sense that it's, you know, I'd sort of say go back to the drawing boards. I think what we see is legislation that does get changed after select committees have reviewed it, and you know, with varying degrees of bipartisan stuff happening in them. I think officials take select committees seriously, and I think officials understand that most of the time their role is advising a minister, but when a bill's in front of a select committee, they understand that they're role is to support the Select Committee, and then and that the Select Committee has a quality assurance role, you know, on a check on the executive government. So I think there's a lot that's good about it. I can't say I've thought a great deal about that bit at the interface. I've thought much more about the bit up to where ministers and cabinet make decisions, you know. So if I had a magic wand and I could change behaviour, I think it would be on that engagement side with communities and with affected people. I think it would be that culture change that makes, you know, some ministers understand that it's a really good idea to send their officials out there, but others are very reticent about it. And sometimes you're told not to, literally told not to. And I know that officials, I've been there myself. You're suddenly in another part of the country with a community that's very different from the one you grew up in, and they're angry with you because you're from the government and you're not doing it right, you know. And so if I could, it would be that thing about sort of saying, let's have a norm that says we engage more at the front end. So people can engage quite well at the Select Committee end, even if not everybody, you know, comes to your hearings and so forth. But I think having more of it at the front end would both end up with better policy advice and it would end up with more trust in government. So that would be the bit I would, and that's why I guess in this role I have been focusing some of our effort in those areas. Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. I do want to thank you for spending a big chunk of your evening with us. I realise it's about 10:30 at night over in New Zealand, and apologies for all the difficulties that we had. I'm not sure which end it was, but it was great that you soldiered on throughout it also. We do really appreciate it. We, as a committee, will continue taking evidence on effective Scottish Government decision-making at future meetings, and I would certainly hope that we can engage in the future. Once more. So that right. Concludes the public part of today's meeting. Next item on agenda, which we'll discuss in private, is consideration of our work programme. So I'll just call a 2-minute recess. So thank you very much again, Diane. Thank you. Enjoy the rest of your evening.
You're welcome. Good luck. I look forward to reading your latest report.